Good morning, everyone, and thank you for tuning in again every Wednesday at 10 a.m. Well, at least we try to start at 10 a.m., but since we're entrepreneurs, we do what we want to do all the time. How are you, Nick?
Lovely.
Great for you to join
us this morning. Lovely, lovely, lovely. It's going to be one of them lovely days. At least the snow, the blizzard, this blizzard's gone. I know that Chicago and especially New York took a huge hit with weather the last couple of days.
Weather was crazy. Everything was canceled. Yeah, I stayed in cozy yesterday.
And, you know, everything was slow yesterday, running slow.
Well, that's kind of... Oh my God, happens. You set yourself up for that one, and I don't even want to take it.
I don't even know what you mean I set myself up.
Everything was slow. I'm like, that's every day for you.
No? Oh,
yay!
Okay.
One for mommy.
Right. All right. All right. Look at that. You got a shot in there. Just remember, I have 45 more minutes to unload all over you. So with that being said, why don't we say who our guest is today? Well, he's not our guest.
He's a
show host, but...
Yes.
Yeah, you're not a guest, dude.
Yeah.
Sorry, man.
Hi, Javi.
I wanted to try and make it grander and more special,
right?
But it's like, it's Javier Garcia.
Javier with the Federal Savings Bank.
You're just as,
Javi today.
That's Javier Garcia, Federal Savings, Savings Bank. Carla Mina, Coa Banker, and I'm just Nick Mametti of iLoan. So here we are.
You're just that.
We have no special news. Someone that's never been on the air today.
No,
it's a rare deal. It's quiet.
Javi called me and said it's going to be all about me today because I rule and rock the VA world. So let's get to it, Javi.
It's the Javier Garcia show.
What's going on?
Right. No, well, definitely wanted to focus on the VA loan product being basically the best loan product out there that's available to anyone who is a veteran compared to conventional financing or FHA financing where you will be required to do a form of down payment. VA actually you can do 100% financing.
Wow.
Without having to worry about mortgage insurance. Mortgage insurance is one of those things that a lot of people focus on the down payment.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it's going to dictate exactly how much mortgage insurance they're going to pay on their loan, right?
Bro, you just threw
VA.
The show's
all
done.
It. It's
the show's
gone. Let's
done.
Go home.
Yeah,
I can go to my next appointment.
You threw the nuclear buttons like right out there in the, you know, you gotta.
There's a lot of moving
You gotta
parts.
Throw the little ones out first.
There's a problem. Alina's not going live. So,
to me, the number one thing that is insane is veterans, which they deserve everything they're getting, and probably some more. Honestly speaking,
right.
When it comes to mortgages, in my opinion, they deserve more across the platform, and we're always going to struggle with not giving them enough. But let's go back to mortgages because that's all we really do know about when it comes to all the political aspects of it. With you said the main thing right there, no money down. This is the only no money down program left in the marketplace. Period. Correct.
Correct.
Focus on that. I mean. No money down.
No money down.
You're looking at
the conforming loan limits. Okay, so anytime that you're looking to purchase a home, as long as you're within the conforming loan limits, it's 100% financing.
That's awesome.
The best thing about VA that is not typical with FHA is that you don't have a cap as to what your loan amount is actually going to be. There is a calculation that you have to figure out in regards to the VA jumbo side. So VA actually does VA jumbo loans. A lot of the times if you hit purchasing, let's say you're looking to purchase a property for $700,000, your conforming loan limits is $424,000.
Correct.
You'll only actually have to be putting a down payment based off of the differential between the county loan limit and the notice of value or purchase price of the home, which is substantial, especially if you're looking at a $700,000 purchase. If you're having to do a 25% down payment on the entire $700,000 amount.
It's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. But if you're only doing 25% down payment on the difference between $424 and $700, you're talking about a substantially lower figure.
Sure.
So you're going to be able to get a jumbo loan.
And how much is the down payment, I'm sorry, on that difference?
It's 25% down payment of the difference between the county loan limit
and
the purchase price or the notice of value. The notice of value is technically once the property has been appraised,
mm-hmm.
that's what's issued by the SAR, which is the underwriter who's reviewing the appraisal from the underwriting.
So essentially, if you're staying within the county norms, you get a no money down.
No money down.
No money down, which you're the only person. Now, the best non-veteran loan is essentially 3%. And now they're starting to come out with these 1% down programs, if you will, but there's still some money down.
Correct.
So the veterans can do completely zero. Let's do some basic math. Go ahead.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but you touch on and Graco and Javi and I were discussing these 1% down loan programs, and I want to make sure that we understand the difference between the two, because you're saying that the VA loan program is the only one that's 100% financing,
mm-hmm.
means you don't have to come out of pocket, no money down. But now there are some marketing strategies out there that are luring buyers into thinking that there are loan programs for 1% down. So if I'm not a veteran, let's just really quick say what's the difference between those two programs and why one is better than the other.
Well, you're not a veteran, so we're not going to tell you.
Nope.
No, I'm just kidding. You know, that's probably a whole other show.
Right, but I want to talk about it because it's trending. There's a lot of social media buzz around these programs.
I'll touch it briefly because I don't want to fall off the tracks of what we're doing here. The 1% down program is still really, generally speaking, not a whole lot of lenders have it, and we'll do a full show on it, but I'll give you the short version. It's really a 3% down program, but you get 2% credit from a lender.
Okay.
And so essentially that turns into, what, 1% for you, the borrower, to put down. And before I go deeper, I don't want the federales calling me, especially because we're talking about VA loans, so I'm going to have to give out my NMLS number, which is 106-3054.
So
never interrupt
one.
The Nick Mometty NMLS number.
I'm
proud to have it.
Nicholas Coffee, see?
I'm proud
Nicholas
to have
Coffee.
It.
Javier Garcia, NMLS 217-343.
So let's go back real quick, and I'm going to run, you know, on my calculator here, just a scenario to give somebody an idea of how big that difference is. So if we have a 420, let's just use Illinois loan amounts here, or most of the counties here in Illinois.
Mm-hmm.
420 max loan, I could do that with no money down on a VA. But let's say I'm a veteran, and I want to buy a $700,000 home. So you're telling me that I actually have to put down 25% on the difference, which is $380,000.
You said 700.
No, the difference from 700 to 420 is 380.
Yeah.
Right. Times 0.25%. So I'm putting $95,000 on a veteran loan if I'm a vet. And if I buy the same $750,000 or $700,000 property and I wasn't a vet, 175.
Right.
It's double. It's pretty good substantial deal.
Pretty substantial.
Pretty substantial. And the rate is still...
It doesn't affect your rate.
It's a fair market rate. You're looking at a VA jumbo. The difference between a standard VA loan and a VA jumbo will probably be looking at about an eighth to a quarter point differential.
Mm-hmm.
But you're still going to be looking at, you know, if you compare it to the jumbo products that are out there, the non-conforming products, still a better lending product than anything else out there on the market.
Now, what about, you know, when you talk about jumbo loans specifically, I know lately I've been dabbling with quite a few of them. The real caveat here is that when you're going to get a jumbo loan approval, it's much more stringent. You know, let's just, the average Joe puts down 20-25% down. They have to have a pretty clean background.
Right.
You know, very little errors on credit, very little issues with income and assets. I mean, it has to be pretty straightforward. Where it feels like when we're doing traditional loans, DU or desktop underwriter, Fannie Freddie, if you will, is a little bit more lenient in some cases. Debt to income ratios can go a little higher. Assets can be a little lower. Credit scores can sometimes still be approved that we thought might not go. But when it comes to jumbo, it's pretty straight-laced.
It's pretty straight-laced, and you're still looking at those flexibility guidelines that you see on a standard VA loan, even with that VA jumbo product. I've seen a couple VA jumbos where we're at a 52-53% debt to income ratio, which we know is never going to fly on the non-conforming side.
No.
Right? Anytime you go over 41-42% debt to
red
income
alert.
Ratio,
red alert.
Red alert, too mm-hmm. much of a risk. Because you're still able to use the AUS scorecard, whether you're using, you know, DU or LP, you're still able to get that flexibility of having those high debt to income ratios, even on a VA jumbo.
Well, it's not even just high debt to income ratio. I mean, I think the total point that I'm making is
even FICO requirements. You can
FICO
go down to a 640 on a lot of the VA jumbo stuff.
If you had some lates 2 years ago, they're disregarded. Not kind of, they're pretty much disregarded.
You guys are totally geeking out here, and you're going with blah 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 all this information.
Well, we're getting at is the credit.
But wait, the credit thing. You just said 640. You can. It's what is the requirement
there
for
no,
a VA?
Technically, on a VA, there is no FICO score requirement.
So it's basically you can get a loan, no money down, and we don't care how much debt to income you have, your ratios, debt to income ratios.
As long as you get an automated underwriting approval,
okay,
you're able to go down. I've seen some
so there's
automated
a lot
underwriting
of flexibility
approvals go down
is what
to
you're
like a 560 credit score, and you can still get an approved eligible automated underwriting approval.
So for a conventional FHA.
But you still
FHA,
need a lender who's going to want that paper. Just because VA states that they don't have a FICO requirement doesn't mean that the lender who's actually going to be securing that note doesn't have their own overlays as to what kind of paper they want.
So when you say you want, you still want a lender that's going to want that paper, what does that mean?
It has to be the credit risk eligibility guidelines that they want to set for themselves,
yeah,
right?
Some
there's
lenders,
certain lenders who don't want to take on higher risk files, and maybe they have a 640, a 650, or a 660 credit
score. Okay, so it depends on the different lenders whether or not they are going to make those allow you to do those credit score restrictions or break mm-hmm. those credit score restrictions?
Lenders it's a copycat world.
Okay.
So usually the grander stroke across the board is one number that seems to hit a nerve. If 640 is that number right now, and I'm not sure what it is right
we
now.
We go down to a 610.
Right. Okay. So that's not saying that, you know, there might be places that will go well below a 640, like Javier just said. Then there might be places that won't. But generally speaking, most lenders are in that same vicinity. But what we are trying to say here is that the flexibility, when we go back to a jumbo loan, if you're a vet buying a jumbo loan, you're going to squeak right in with a lot of VA flexibility.
Absolutely.
Where if you're not a vet going for that same exact loan on that same exact house, you're going to have a much more stringent underwriting process than a vet would.
Absolutely.
So that's the benefit that goes with having the VA card.
Okay,
so,
well, let's go back to that average person, not the jumbo market, right? Because what did we say? Average is
211,
230,
yeah, somewhere in the
wherever you are, right? So we're talking about to that buyer. If you're a first-time buyer looking to acquire something in less than $250,000, you're comparing the two loan programs. Granted, you're not a veteran, but you know, you're going to be using the FHA loan program. So can we say, what are the differences between those two programs if you're a first-time buyer and you're not a veteran versus if you are a veteran, so we can understand the differences? Let's start with credit score.
Down payment, and then debt to income ratios.
Obviously, with FHA, you're going to have to do a 3.5% down payment.
Right.
With VA, you would require no down payment.
And then every time you don't do a down payment, you have to pay that mortgage insurance to secure or, you know, to protect the lender's investment in your purchase. So you have
right.
to carry
with FHA,
that insurance.
You have two mandatory mortgage insurances that you're going to pay. You're going to have an upfront mortgage insurance
right.
premium that you pay to HUD, and then you have a monthly mortgage insurance.
And what are those amounts?
The monthly mortgage insurance for FHA, I believe, is 0.85 annually. So that's a revolving mortgage insurance
doesn't
premium
go anywhere.
That's based off of the balance.
And it used to be that once you had 20% equity in the property, that would go away. But now
right.
it's there for the life
down
of the loan.
With FHA, that goes down to a 0.80.
Okay.
Right? So you're able to at least differentiate that and bring that down some by putting a higher down payment.
Okay.
But in most cases, you're always going to have that upfront mortgage insurance premium with FHA.
And how much
with
is
VA,
that, Javi?
It's 1.75%.
Okay.
So anytime that you're financing with FHA, mm-hmm. you're automatically adding 1.75% premium onto your loan balance.
Right.
With VA, you
and that's
only
a one-time
pay a funding
fee, though.
You only pay a funding fee if you don't have a service-related disability. So there's a lot of veterans out there that will pay that 2.15 funding fee that you
okay.
pay to VA, which
okay.
is your first-time use. But if you have a service-related disability, you pay 0% funding fee upfront.
Wow.
And zero mortgage insurance.
That's awesome.
So right off the bat, no down payment, no mortgage insurance on the VA loan product. You only pay the upfront mortgage insurance premium if you don't have a service-related disability.
Right.
So by far, it's definitely, they mirror each other in regards to interest rates. It's just that you're going to have a lower monthly payment and more buying power with
right.
the VA loan product, because on an average note of $250,000, if you're looking at the actual MIP, here, just simple math.
It's just under $200 a month.
Yeah.
Which is great, because that's
$177 a month that you're going to be saving. That $177 will be able to,
like, if you're buying a condo,
$15,000 to $20,000 more in house,
right? And or, you know, afford a condo with higher assessments per se, right? Because it all
higher
give
assessments.
And take.
The one thing with condos is just like FHA,
yep.
the association has to be approved.
Okay.
So it goes through the same rigorous process as FHA condo approvals. VA approvals go through the same thing.
All right. And just before we forget, what were the credit score requirements, too? You were going to make the difference between the FHA loan program versus the VA?
With our organization, we can go down to a 610 FICO score. I know that I've sent a couple deals over to Graco over at iLoans where they can go down to a 580 FICO score. So
wow, look at that.
Okay. You got to use the network, right?
You got to use the network.
It really depends on anyone out there and exactly what credit criteria they currently have. You know, like I said, it doesn't have a FICO requirement. I've seen some lenders who will go down to like a 550, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Not a lot of people have that appetite for that kind of paper because they consider it a higher risk. Those people
for
have a 550 credit score
right.
for a reason, right? So it's all about making sense. You know, there's this gray area in finance, and you always want to make sure that you're putting the client in the best ability for them to be able to repay the loan and for them to succeed. There's no point in putting them into a home if they're not going to be able to pay their mortgage.
Now,
right.
somebody listening to this show heard that they don't have to put money down, which they deserve, hears that they could take out a bigger loan, cheaper than most people, which they deserve. They're a lot more forgiving on their credit requirements, which they deserve. But then, you know, you're building up the American dream to someone that really, truly deserves it, probably more than anybody else in the marketplace, right?
For sure.
Right.
But it all sounds so risky.
Why?
And we just told you why. No down payment. Credit score doesn't have to be very
risky
good.
Risky to the lender, but
it's well, risky to the person taking out the loan because you don't want to give someone a home that they can lose. It's the worst feeling. You're almost better off never buying one if you have to stare foreclosure down the face, correct?
Right.
So how is it if, and you're over here talking about debt-to-income ratios seem to be more forgiving, the, you know, typically a 42 back-end debt-to-income ratio, for those that are listening, that's the total amount of debt you have to pay against your gross income. And for a vet, you can go to 50. You've seen it. You've seen 52 debt-to-income ratio, which is substantially higher than the norm. But it sounds like they're being set up to fail. So is there anything in place in underwriting for the income levels? I mean, we already don't have to make – we don't have to get a down payment here. We're forgiving with credit scores. And now you're telling me that the income can be stretched. I just see red flags that this might have a problem.
Absolutely.
I'm not calling out any veteran not pay
this
their bill.
This is like no skin in the game type of conversation.
Sometimes people don't.
No, it's not no, a
no,
not
skin,
no skin
in the
game.
Game. There's another thing in here that is
what?
Part
because
of the residuals.
Now you're being insulting to those
so,
people.
No.
Just
oh
saying.
No, there's a point to this.
No,
please.
Go ahead. Well, he's talking about his residuals, right? So we want to make sure there's a calculation on VA loans where they want to make sure, because you do have that flexibility of going to higher debt to income ratios.
Okay.
That there is a certain residual threshold that they meet, which means that they have enough income in the household after all of their expenses, although not only housing, but other debt obligations they might currently have, to be able to meet their sustainability for living.
Okay.
And this is the
right.
only loan program that does exist where you have
where
to
you
do that. You
have
to qualify
have to
on what would be known as like almost a secondary debt to income ratio.
Correct.
So there is, as much as we threw all these bells and whistles and, you know, what was the show of last week? Free money?
Free money.
Right.
This now
is,
you're saying
now we're saying
100%
easy loans.
Easy loans.
We're saying super easy loans. And it is an easy loan compared to the rest of the marketplace as
right.
as deserved. But you don't want to give somebody that deserves an opportunity, you don't want to set them up to fail either, because that's a mental breakdown at some point. You can, it's daunting to know that you can't afford this house. Who gave me this loan? They
right.
should have been looking out for me. So,
but
the veteran loans,
monthly payment makes sense
loans,
for them.
Well,
like, I don't understand your whole concept.
Well, they, look.
Underwriting guidelines, yes, but if you're
veteran
saying
loans have a secondary cash flow concern.
The subprime market kind of dictated itself, right? It was all about, can you afford the payment? Yeah,
right,
could
the monthly
the
payment.
Payment,
your carrying cost. Well, if you're well, saying you don't have a mortgage insurance
secondary
premium.
Secondary cash flow, this is the only loan in the marketplace that requires an analysis on their actual cash flow. You know, just because your debt to income ratio when you came into me showed 42% and you qualify,
yeah.
There's things that I can't find on a credit report that you have to pay for on a regular basis. There's other expenses that come up to you
like
that
what,
we would never
example?
Be able to see.
Utility expenses, living expenses.
Yeah, I mean, you want full-blown cable bills where every, you know, you need HBO Showtime and every bells and whistles, and, you know, your cable bill is not $150 like the normal person, but it's $400.
I
can't
TV.
See that. It's an example.
Right.
Your cell phone.
Yep,
you, we would think you have a $100
month.
A month cell
too
phone bill, but
usage.
You know, maybe you're one of those people that loves to call overseas and you have an $800
right.
you know,
you're,
cell phone.
It really depends.
I don't know.
Really
there's a lot of ways
no,
that
you're
looking
so
at your
true.
Budget.
There's bills that
yeah.
everybody has that we don't really are required to ask for. On
but,
a veteran loan, we actually are.
Wow,
right.
okay.
Right.
So don't be upset if you're a veteran and you have to go through this.
It's to
process.
Protect you, more, most importantly. We're,
okay.
we're more than happy to give out the loan and to approve you. I mean, I know that when we see VA loan pre-approvals, we're
right.
like, okay, this is going to be one of the easier loans to get done, but we want to also make sure it performs. Without it performing, that's bad news, not just for that particular veteran, but the whole veteran pool of funds that are out there. If it's starting to perform, eventually they will make it a little tighter because defaults are a problem, you know, and veteran loans have been performing very well recently.
Yeah. Love it. So. Gentlemen, so we talked about loan limits. We talked about how to qualify and, of course, the process. What about property types? Is there specifics on the property? Because I know with FHA, the property itself has to qualify, not just the borrower. What are the restrictions with property types?
There's really not a lot of restrictions in regards to, you know, a lot of people have this assumption that just like FHA, a VA, you know, property is going to have a lot of restrictions. The property cannot have any form of a safety hazard to the occupant. So the property has to be eligible for owner occupancy from day one. That's number one. A lot of people have a lot of ideas that maybe scrape painting and things like that is something that is also going to be predominant with
really?
VA. It's not as predominant with VA as it is with FHA.
Right, that's what I was going to ask you.
Confuse me. Appraisers do not, you know, care about chip paint or anything like that on the exterior walls or anything like that. They're more focusing on safety hazards, making sure that appliances and everything is there in the property because it has to be available for occupancy from day one.
So the kitchen does have to have appliances. So if you're looking at a
correct.
Foreclosed property, those are things that you have to look for. Make sure that they have appliances. What about holes in the walls? And like you
it's got to be move-in ready.
It's got to be move-in ready.
Occupant.
It can't be a tender, loving care property.
But I can bring in the appliances. Can I? No, that's just getting too complicated. The borrower can bring it. I mean, if we're buying a foreclosure, and I've had this case where, you know, you got this amazing deal. God knows we don't have a lot of inventory, so now we have to be creative out there. And when we say creative property types, if you have a foreclosure or a short sale where the seller is not doesn't have the capability of providing those things or cleaning that up so we can pass your FHA and VA inspections, then are we allowed to bring in our own appliances just for the appraisal?
Oh, well, I don't like the way you just said that.
But wait, no? Okay.
Yeah, no, you cannot just bring them in just for your appraisal.
No, to keep, right? Because we're going to occupy the property.
I'm going to let you jump into that one.
We're going to keep these
appliances. You can answer these Carla Mina questions.
Yeah, we're going to keep these properties.
I'm keeping my NMLS number. Thank you very much.
Sorry. I didn't mean it like for temporary. Duh. We're buying the property.
I just care about what you said.
They can definitely bring in their own appliances.
Thank you, Javier.
For the final inspection.
Nick's always throwing me under the bus. Jesus Christo.
Can't be associated with
people
like you.
Actually had that happen predominantly in Florida.
No, I'm all hot. Oh,
yeah,
geez.
In Florida, I would have that happen. Carlamina,
real estate, MLS ID. No money. But, okay, yeah, but seriously, it's complicated out there, Nick. It's a rough, rough life. Chipping paint. No, because seriously, I had an issue with a client who was borrowing money, and it was a VA program, and there was chipping paint, and he was like, I'm not going to fix this property before it's even mine, right? Because what are the chances that you are going to get financing and this is going to go through, right? Even there's always, you know, uncertainty. You're not 99% or 90, you know, you're not 100% sure you're going
to
get a loan.
I seen back in the 90s, a loan officer went to a house.
Seriously, these are real
and
nightmares.
I seen a loan officer go to a house and paint the gutters.
What? You guys don't do any of this.
That wasn't, I had a friend. And I go,
Carlos was like, who is this guy?
Who is this guy? What's his number?
He didn't even work with me, but I called him up. I wanted to see what he was doing this evening. It was Saturday. If he wanted to go out, I was 24 years old or 23 years old. And I'm like, hey, what are you doing tonight? You want to go out? He's like, nah, I'm spending the day. I got to go paint a garage. I'm like, oh, who? Your dad's making you do it or your uncle or what? Nah, I got to go paint the gutters on this house. It's an FHA loan. I'm like, you're kidding me, right? He said he was going to paint the gutters because it wouldn't pass.
And you laugh.
There was a lot of flaking and you know, chipping. But the loan officer went out to paint the gutters. And to me, I just said, you know what? You clearly don't close enough loans. That you got to go paint.
That is so mean. Whatever happened to going above and beyond?
I personally feel that I should not be involved in a transaction at all like that. So I will not go paint anyone's gutter unless it's my own gutter.
Yeah.
You know, and that's it. And I would even paint that gutter. I'd call for a new gutter. I'd do well. Give me a new gutter. Let's do this.
Oh, gosh. This is going back to what you can and cannot do.
Let's go back to...
Nice to meet you, Nick.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
And then
one
thing to, you know, just because we are in the city of Chicago, so there's a lot of condos and things like that, always make sure that you're checking with the association for the condo approval.
Mm-hmm.
If it's not VA approved, at least still get a condo questionnaire. You know, we're able to do a review of a condo questionnaire and immediately know whether or not the property will meet VA approval eligibility. We've been able to do some condo approvals in as little as 25 to 35 days.
Shut up, really?
Yes. So as long as you have a motivated seller and we have a condo questionnaire that we can verify is going to meet the VA requirements, we can set up a 60-day to 90-day close of escrow on a contract, and we could go ahead and get the association approved, and it's going to be something that's going to benefit the entire building.
So this is something where you can actually make... So the building, because that's issue with being in the metro city and mm-hmm. having these buildings sometimes not being FHA or VA approved. You're basically telling me that even if they don't have that qualification that or it's not known that they're approved, that you can.
They're not currently approved, but if they're able to provide a condo questionnaire and we're able to review it and see that they meet all of their requirements for the VA approval.
So then you'll get the
building approved. We will actually get everything filed in with the VA department directly and get the association approved.
So they can buy. So clearly they can buy a condo.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they can buy a single-family house because, generally speaking, every show we do is kind of geared around the average, which is a single-family home.
Right.
What about 2 units, 3 units, 4 units? Can they go over 4 units?
No.
Oh.
4 units is a cap.
Oh, so that's where we're going with this property requirement.
Yeah, 4 units is a cap, but the beautiful part about the VA product that is not similar to the FHA product is that the three to four units on FHAs, they have to have a self-sufficiency test that they need to meet. Right. So,
what the heck is that? I do mortgages. I don't even know what that is.
Yes?
All right. So, I ended up learning this like the hard way. So, back in November, I ended up having a deal, right? These three units.
Mine, so.
These 3 units and 4 units in Chicago are starting to get to those $700, $800, $900 price points.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
FHA now has a self sufficiency test. So, they want to make sure if you're buying a 3 to 4 unit property, that based off of the rental income projections that property is going to generate, mm-hmm. it's going to be able to cover its own liability. So it has to be able to cover its mortgage.
The mortgage or operating expenses, just the mortgage. Okay. Through rental income. Okay.
PITI, whatever the FHA, you know, PITI mortgage with MI is going to be.
So it's kind of forcing you to put more money down if that doesn't cover.
If it's in a specific higher price point, it's going to force you to put a higher down payment. So you won't be able to go in with just a 3.5% down payment.
Okay.
That is something that it's irrelevant for the VA. Now, the one thing that I've noticed with 3 to 4 units is that the AUS scorecard with, you know, DU and LP, which is the Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac underwriting approval engine, it takes a little bit into consideration the income and whether or not you're using the qualifying income from the properties generating for the qualifying ratios, and will sometimes require a 3% down payment. I've had a couple of my buyers that were required to put a 3% down payment because of high debt to income ratios, and it was a 3 to 4 unit property. On a single family, they were able to do 100% financing.
Wow. Okay.
So it's always very, very important that whatever loan officer is working on your file, if you are going
to
be buying a 3 to 4 unit property, have to have your AUS run to make sure that you're still able to do that 100% financing. Because I had a couple of veterans, they were forced to have to do a 3% financing because if we were to do a manual underwrite, that would take down the ratio significantly when you're doing manual underwriting on VA loans.
Now, you know, I'm aware of how to do a VA loan. I haven't done a ton, you know, but I understand the guidelines, and I have done plenty, which have gone very smooth. But I do believe that when you're going into a specialty program, and I consider VA specialty program,
right,
because I think that it's more advantageous for a client to have a very well-versed VA loan officer.
Mm-hmm.
They'll find out extra little things that they could have benefited on versus someone who's very vanilla.
Right.
You know, just because we know how to do the loan doesn't mean we're as good as, I'll say this
the
right here, me
right?
versus Javier. I excel in other programs, but we do have in our office, and I think every lender that's good in today's world has loan officers that do excel in the VA program.
Mm-hmm.
It's so important. I mean, I know my entire office in Minnesota had to get VA loan certified. Every single loan officer in that building. So if I get stuck, I just easily call up there and give it to one of the nerds up there. They're all over every little thing. But I think vets should be aware that you probably want to make sure you're talking to a loan officer that has done a substantial amount of VA loans just to make sure you have every little option available to you. You know, or what
well,
to get
but
into.
It's good because you know all the ins and outs. Mm. I mean, most recently, I was the listing agent on one of a property, and we got a call for it. You know, we did the appraisal, and then they scheduled the termite inspection. And of course, you know, I was like, yeah, let's schedule it. But my client was like, why are we doing a termite inspection? It's a brick home. And I'm like, you just have to do a termite inspection. Well, it's a waste of money. Why are we doing a termite inspection? And then, you know, the seller has to pay for it, right?
Correct. The seller or the lender.
But what?
So if a vet's buying my house and I'm selling,
yes, exactly.
I have a termite inspection coming up that I have to pay for?
Yep, even if your property's a brick.
But
no, well, but those are things. I mean, good. Like, my client was like, when were you going to tell me? I'm like, you know, like, it's just, you know, business, real estate as usual. There's so much going on, and we're more upset about these people getting their appraiser out there, and then all of a sudden we get hit with a termite inspection. So it's good to know whether you're, you know, buying or selling property. If you
right.
accept an offer that comes in with a VA loan certificate or a VA loan approval, you have to remember to expect that you are going to be responsible, unless, of course, the lender covers it.
Right. Well, in most cases, it's always supposed to be, and it's actually not in most cases, it always has to be the seller or your lender covering the expense.
Why is that?
A lot of the times when you have a buyer, what a buyer will usually do is we'll order a termite inspection, they'll pay the inspection, but then receive a reimbursement. That's at least what I do with all of my buyers, right? So I want to make sure that everything goes well with the termite inspection, everything comes out. We go ahead and process it. If the termite company is unwilling to release the report without payment, that's where they place their deposit, and then they get receive the reimbursement at the time of closing. But in all cases, a buyer is not supposed to be paying for a termite inspection at any time.
Dope. See, we have to, and that's what we do here at Market Overdrive. Thank you so much for listening. I do want to plug in that we want everybody to subscribe to our YouTube channel because I
plug
feel
it.
Like it.
Plug it. Plug it.
YouTube.
Plug YouTube.
YouTube. Oh my
Follow
gosh, you guys are
YouTube.
So weird today. Yes, definitely YouTube. Subscribe. All this information is available for you to, you know, share with your friends. Please, this is great information because not everybody knows about VAs and how to qualify for them. So, of course, you can always reach us at info@marketoverdrive.com, and we've covered termite inspection, but what about the wells and septic you mentioned?
Right. So in the suburbs, which is something very common, when you don't have a public
rural
water.
Rural areas.
Yeah, rural areas.
You
I
said
like
that
to
right?
Rural. Suburbs.
English
rural.
Is my second language.
But anytime you don't have a public water system and
yep.
you have a well system, you do need to get a well bacteria and nitrates inspection done. And that's where they actually check your water system, make sure that there's no bacteria or nitrates, you know, higher doses of levels are in there where it could be a danger to the family who's going to be consuming this water. So just that's one thing to make sure. We usually don't know that determination until we get the appraisal back. The appraisal will definitely dictate what the water source for the property will be. So anytime you're out in the burbs or in rural areas, always ask whether or not what the water source was a public water source or whether it's a well source. If it's a well source, know that you will need to require, you will be required to get that bacteria and nitrates inspection.
Love it. Lots of information today. And of course, if you want to know more again and again, email us at info@marketoverdrive.com. And I really wish I knew what Nick was laughing about because we're trying to wrap up the
show. Can't tell you.
You're so annoying in life.
All I can tell you is this is a great program.
Hey, Nick, what are we talking about next week?
I don't know. What are we talking about next week? Real estate. I'll talk about anything under the sun.
How to buy an income. Apparently not how to clean gutters or fix gutters.
I will not clean
paint
gutters.
How to buy an income property. Two flats. See?
Why does it have to be specifically about two flats?
Income property. Okay, not two flats.
But four flats.
Two to four.
And this is why it's so annoying to powwow with
him. Give me a condo that's an income property.
Yeah. Buy an income property. He's just upset because he's...
Well, here's the good news. I'm really good at that.
You're good at that?
Yes.
Finally, something you're good at.
I gave you a sample size of some of the stuff that I bought. There wasn't a two flat or a three flat or a four flat.
It is exactly what I was going to do, put you on blast, but you know how you hate me for me to say that? Because you get so complicated when it comes to making money, Nick, that I just rather not talk about it on the air.
I feel like I make money, but I don't have any. I don't understand what happens here. So, you know, but we'll teach you how to make it. You do whatever you want with it.
That's just don't do what Nick does.
Yeah, don't do what I do. Yes, that's
TMI
exciting.
Who's
a guest next week?
Oh, your best friend. What's his name?
I have a lot of best friends.
Really, I doubt that.
Like I have best friend number 543, number 544.
Can we not? Anyway, Javi, next week it's gonna be Graco Funes.
Oh, he's like number 364, 365.
Am I like number one?
No, you're like 700, 900. 7,800.
Nice to meet you, Nick. Right, I love you too. I like these cards. I need new cards. Anyway, thank you so much for tuning in. This is a wrap because Carlamina has to go far, far, especially since you were late today and now you messed up my schedule. Thank you very much.
You're
going
to live. I think we got the most important part of the VA stuff out of the way, but if you do have questions, obviously go to our site.
Javi killed it.
He's
awesome.
312-738-6074. Be more than happy to walk you through your VA loan approval process at any time.
Whoa, we forgot something very important.
Oh, gosh.
I cannot finish this show and not mention something about the VA. I'm sorry. We have to...
Back up.
You're... Holy cow.
What is wrong with you? What?
What if you're married to a vet?
What? Just
and
say it.
And the vet dies.
Surviving spouse.
Surviving spouse gets to do these loans. We cannot leave this show and forget to mention.
Did you see that only, it gets dark in here all
only,
of a sudden?
And this is very important.
Nick talks about death and it
if
gets
you're
dark
a surviving
in the studio.
Spouse,
seriously.
You cannot remarry. You cannot remarry ever again.
So that
or you will lose.
Down.
You will lose
oh
your
God,
ex-spouse's veteran benefits.
But wait a minute.
So
let's
remember,
complicate it a little bit.
I'm sorry. We can't. That's a big thing to forget.
That's a big
wait,
thing.
Wait a minute, guys. So, okay. So I'm married to a vet. What? And I get the certificate, and unfortunately, you know, there's a death.
He passes away. You're eligible on all these programs, just like if he was here to do it himself.
But then if I remarry, he goes away, but I already have my house.
That's his way of haunting you, saying you should have never remarried.
Crazy.
You should have never remarried. Give me my benefits
or
back.
Or she, because right. There's
yeah,
women.
She,
vets.
Yeah,
he or she,
veterans.
Right.
Power
it's
to the
spouse.
People,
the
women.
Spouse gets the same benefits as the deceased veteran. And if we would have left this
that's
show
like
and forgotten that,
story.
That
would have
been a huge boo-boo.
Can I tell you how mean and evil you guys are? You're like, that's a way of hunting you for the rest of your
haunting
life.
You,
haunting
you.
Haunting you.
Haunting
you.
Not hunting. Haunting.
Oh, sorry.
Haunting.
Glitches
not
my
hunting.
Second.
No one's going to hunt you down.
We're going to hunt you down.
We're
going
to hunt you down.
Like, made me lose. It's not
you
about
lose your car.
Haunting you.
Lose.
It's about taking care of you after death.
Yeah, well, then when
yeah.
someone
how
else
romantic
decides
is
to.
That?
That is romantic, and that's great.
It's really romantic.
But if someone
love
else
it.
Is going to come in and take care of you after him.
Someone's sleeping in my bed, honey.
He's pulling back his benefits, which I don't blame him.
And this is how Market Overdrive goes from like family show to like a Nick show and a Javi show, which
hey,
unfortunately I don't like
that.
Where this is
the
going.
The Nick and Javi show.
Look at Javi. I
something
like that
should be on Telemundo. All right.
Are you kidding me?
We're signing.
This
Telemundo
is Market
we're
Overdrive.
Signing
Carla,
we're
Carla.
Coming. Market Overdrive is over. We will see you next week where we teach you how to make money and how to buy investment properties more
two
than
flats.
Just two flats.
Have
see
a great
you next
day.
Week at 10 a.m.
Ciao.
Wednesday. Bye.